Hi, this is Holly with Presence Point, and welcome back to our 2 Peter series. We're winding up our time in this epistle this week by looking at verses 11 through 18 of chapter 3. Let's begin by reading verses 11 through 13. Since all of these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn? But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. In verse 11, Peter is reminding us of his earlier words. The end will come for the earth and the heavens as we know them, with a roar and with fire. In fact, we learned in our time together last week that it'll be with intense, incomprehensible heat that the elements will be destroyed. Interestingly, Peter goes on not to say that it's important that you figure out when this destruction is going to happen, but instead, in essence, he said, you better find out the kind of person you ought to be. You see, Peter was not concerned with how long we would have our stuff or when we were going to lose all that we'd accumulated. He is saying, look, since everything is going to be destroyed, you need to be living lives of holiness and godliness. He is telling us to be vigilant, intentional in the way we wait for the day of God. St. Augustine said it this way, he who loves the coming of the Lord is not he who affirms that it is far off, nor is it he who says it is near, but rather he who, whether it be far off or near, awaits it with sincere faith, steadfast hope, and fervent love. Peter is telling those of us who believe in Jesus that we need to live like we believe in Jesus and his word, holy and godly in all of our behaviors, set apart, clearly demonstrating who we are, sons and daughters of the King, and whose we are. In the context of our conversation, we can apply that to how we shepherd, how we influence and impact those the Father has placed in our lives. Our decisions, our behaviors and interactions, in other words, should look different than those of leaders who are not Christ followers. Peter is saying that we must be conscientious and attentive to how we live and the behaviors we demonstrate. He shares with his readers that in light of the fact that the world is temporary and Jesus is coming back soon, holy and godly conduct are obviously wise choices that we need to be demonstrating. We need to be sincere and committed to what we believe, unwavering in our hope in the Almighty, and full of passionate love for others, including the lost, reaching out to them so they know how desperately we want them to know Jesus. Peter tells us that we are not just to wait for the coming of the day of God in that manner, but that we can actually hasten or quicken its coming by living accordingly. It seems that if sin delays the day of God, then living in light of his word might actually quicken it. After all, Peter said a few verses earlier that the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise as some count slowness, but is delaying his return in order that those who remain in their sin might be repentant and come to him. This truly gave me pause because I had to consider that my desire for the day of God to come quickly completely discounts the need of those who have not yet come to him. After all, what if the one he's waiting for is one of the sheep in your lives or my life that you've been praying for or I've been praying for, that works for you or worships with you or lives next door to you? Perhaps living holy and godly lives with a passionate love for the lost might well attract more unbelievers to him and in the process speed up his coming. Now there's something I think we should chew on a while, shepherd leaders. In verse 13, Peter reminds us that God has promised new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Our God is patient, but his patience will come to an end. He has promised this new heaven and new earth, and it will come. Some people wonder, of course, though, why anyone would look forward to the destruction of this current universe. After all, there's great beauty in our world, right? But a dear friend says it this way, as much as I am grateful for this present earth, I'd rather live on a perfect earth, where there will be no sin, no decay, no death, no terrorists, no fear, no identity theft, no hospitals, no morticians, no band-aids, no prescription drugs, no dentists, no bankruptcy, no attorneys, no lawsuits, no divorces, no accidents, no body shops, no addictions, no rehab centers, and no high blood pressure. I mean, who can't agree with the attractiveness of perfection in the world, right? In the last five verses of this epistle, though, Peter returns to using this sweet term, beloved, and says this, "Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace. And count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you according to the wisdom given him, as he does in all his letters when he speaks in them of these matters." There are some things in them that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction as they do the other scriptures. "You, therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you are not carried away with the error of lawless people and lose your own stability, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." Peter's reminding us, which seems to be a theme in 2 Peter, right? Reminders, that we should be waiting for God and what he's promised, and that we should be doing so with an attitude that makes a difference in our personal conduct. We are to make every effort. In other words, to be eager to do our best to live spotless, blameless lives and live at peace with the Father. In light of his coming, we are to live our lives to honor him. This is a reminder of the responsibility of every true believer to exert himself or herself in developing Christian conduct. We have both the privilege and the responsibility to make every effort, to eagerly exert ourselves in seeking to deepen and grow in our Christian progress, and according to Peter, particularly in personal holiness. Alistair Begg of Truth for Life Ministries points out that this is not a call to ethical activity, meaning, as he says, to pull up your socks and to try your best. It goes beyond that to a responsibility. To understand this, let's go back to Philippians 2 and Paul's exhortation to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. This making every effort thing is a responsibility we have, something we're called to do as children of the King, as his under shepherds who are actively influencing and impacting those inside and outside of the body of Christ. Paul then goes on to tell us, "For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." In other words, we are called then by the energizing power of the Spirit to work out what God, by his regenerating power, has placed within the core of our being. And what has he put at the core of our being? Well, remember what Peter said in the first chapter of this letter? His, God's, divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. He's given us what we need, but this is not a passive relationship. We need to make every effort, eagerly and with enthusiasm, to live righteously. And don't forget, where effort is required, exertion is essential. Are we working the godly and holy living muscles the Father has given us? I mean, we all know what happens when we don't work a muscle. So are you, am I, are we doing what we need to exert that muscle daily, hourly? Let's be clear. In fact, let's just call it out, okay? Making every effort does not mean showing up to a building on a certain day of the week, or watching a service online when it's convenient, or reading the Bible through in a year in a manner that just checks the task off of a list. To be honest, I've been there, done that, and it does not cut it. Making every effort means exactly that, producing all the strength and power we have toward a goal. And the goal? Being like Jesus. Now, let me ask an even tougher question. Do you put the same effort toward being like Jesus that you do toward making your quarterly bonus at work? Or getting back into that favorite pair of jeans? Or in being seen so you're up for the next promotion? Peter is requiring us to ask ourselves these tough questions, and I've had to ask myself many of these, even in the process of this blog. Let's not forget what else Peter wrote in this letter to us. He did not just say, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish, but he also said to be at peace. The privilege we've been granted as a child of the King, as his under-shepherd, is not just a responsibility to make every effort to live a godly life, but it includes being at peace with the Father. Now, if you say, "Hey, Holly, I'm a follower of Jesus. I've made my peace with him," I would say, "That's awesome. Me too." But remember, you can be in a relationship with someone and not be at peace with them in any particular moment. I mean, how many of us have marriage licenses that indicates we're wedded to our spouses, but does that mean we're living at peace with them right now, with that person? When was the last time you asked the Father to search your heart and know you? And by that, I mean, when was the last time you asked him to look at the crevices deep within your heart and soul and help you know you? Is there a confession there that needs to take place that would make your relationship truly at peace with him right now? More vibrant and active with the God of the universe and our Master and Lord Jesus Christ? Are you in harmony with him today? I know, more tough questions. Believe me, it took some tears and praying before I could even complete this blog. So, oh, the power of conviction. Holy Spirit's been at work in my house today. Peter goes on to essentially say in verse 15, "Consider, bear in mind that it's because of God's patience that Christ has not yet come back." So in the Holly translation of this verse, I hear Peter saying this to me: stop whining about the fact that you're still waiting for Christ to come back. Side note, the people Peter was writing to literally at that point in time had only been 30 or so years past when Jesus has ascended into heaven. Okay, back to the Holly translation. I hear Peter saying this to me: it's your impatient selfishness that wants Jesus to return now anyway, moving you closer to the new heavens and the new earth. Our Father, however, wants as many to come to him and accept him as their Savior as his patience will allow. His patience, Peter is saying to me, is the reason he's not yet returned. He's looking at the big picture while you're looking at the here and now, only your perspective. I'm not sure how close the Holly translation is to Peter's intent, but it brings home to me how graciously patient our God is. It's exactly what Paul has reminded us of in some of his letters too. After all, maybe he's waiting for your loved one, your best friend, your child's spouse to come to him. Peter takes a moment for a little bit of a rabbit trail next, although it works perfectly with his reminders in chapter 2. He says this: even though some of the matters Paul speaks of are hard to understand, they are wisdom given to him by the Father. And because they're hard to understand, there will be those who are ignorant and unstable, the false teachers he referred to earlier in this letter, who will twist Paul's words in other parts of Scripture. And then Peter says, but, beloved, there's that word of endearment again, right? Knowing this will happen, be on guard. Beware, be careful, be alert. Do not be naive, do not be self-confident. Know that false teachers will exist and they will twist God's word. So watch out for it and don't fall for it. This is a great reminder of what Peter had experienced, right? Because every time we rely on ourselves and not the Father, it's bad news. Remember the three denials before the rooster crowed? He was so confident that he would not deny his Lord, and then boom, less than 3 hours after Peter says, though they all fall away because of you, I will never fall away. Less than 3 hours after he said that, he denied Jesus not once, but three times. Paul said it this way: let the one who thinks he stands take heed in case he falls. In just these few verses, Peter has said, make every effort, bear in mind, and now he adds, grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Peter knows that knowledge without grace is a terrible weapon, and that grace without knowledge can be terribly shallow. But when we combine the two, we have remarkable tools for building our lives and the church for Christ. He also knows that growing spiritually is the only way we'll not be easily enticed and led astray. I'm told that constantly growing is the literal translation of growing in grace. So just as we grow continually, as we grow physically from child to adult, we should be growing continually in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus. You know, it may sometimes seem like children grow in spurts, but the reality is a child is growing a little every day in different ways that we can't see. we too should be constantly experiencing development and spiritual growth, which is growth in grace. As Bible commentator Warren Wiersbe has said, we were saved by grace, but grace does not end there. We must also be strengthened by grace. God's grace can enable us to endure his suffering. His grace also helps us to give when giving is difficult and to sing when singing is difficult. We never really experience the grace of God until we're at the end of our own resources. And it seems to me that each time I'm at the end of my own resources, it is in God's grace and even knowledge of him that I grow. Growing in knowledge seems like it's so much easier than growing in grace, doesn't it? And if Peter's admonition was to grow in knowledge of the Bible, well, I suppose it would be easier. After all, we probably all have more knowledge of what the Bible says than we actually live out on a daily basis. But that's not what Peter said. He said, grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's one thing to know the Bible. It's quite another to know, believe in, have a relationship with the Son of God. Interestingly, the better we know Christ through the Word of God, the more we grow in grace. And the more we grow in grace, the more we understand the Word of God. Peter knew that spiritual growth requires both grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior. So Peter has been just as straightforward in the closing portion of his letter as he was with his earlier words. He's made it clear to his beloved, which now includes us, that while we wait for our Lord to return, we are to be diligent. We are to make every effort to live a holy and godly life in harmony with those around us. We are to bear in mind the why behind the delay of Christ's return. We are to be alert to false teachers and falling astray from following God's word. And we are to grow in grace and the knowledge of our good, great, and chief shepherd. So what does that mean to us as shepherd leaders? Well, I think it means just about everything. He's placed us in positions of influence, whether it's as parent, pastor, CEO, supervisor, grandparent, manager, board member, volunteer, community leader. We are impacting those around us, everyone we encounter, every single day. And we can do it in a godly way, representing well our Father and the Savior. Or we can do it our own way. If we choose to abide by the Father's words, delivered through a letter from Peter, we will be intentional about how we live. We will make an enthusiastic effort to live as his word requires, in harmony with him. We will be alert to what is being taught, who we allow to influence us, and we will grow in our Father's grace and in the knowledge of the Son of God. In other words, our lives will look different. People will notice, and the sheep in our lives will move toward the Father. They'll want what we have. They'll be drawn to where we work, what we do, and where we worship. And that, fellow under shepherd, is part of our mission in this world. As Peter closed his epistle, I will close this series. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. Thank you for joining me.